Well, you had a song.
Yeah, but you
know, okay, go ahead and grab your hymn books again. I got messed up and I got straightened down. I was looking forward to Brooklyn special today, but we need to sing together again right before that. So go ahead and grab your hymn book, Stand Together. Brother Tim will lead us page 86 in your hymn book. Come to the Garden, page 86, In the Garden, amen. And then Brooklyn, just right after the song, you go ahead and come on up and we'll have everything ready for you for special just before the message today, amen. Brother Tim, you ready? Page 86. She's got a beautiful voice. Need to keep her singing. Keep that up. Brooklyn, that's a wonderful job and a wonderful blessing to us. Thank you so much for that. Well, if you'll open your Bible to 2 Thessalonians chapter number 3, 2 Thessalonians chapter number 3, once again, our study through Paul's letters in the to the Thessalonians. We've gone verse by verse through the first letter, 1 Thessalonians. We're in the second letter, and we're in the final chapter. And so we'll be finishing this up probably in a couple of weeks or so. But we're looking at this subject of practical advice that the Apostle Paul is giving to us here in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 and verse 1 down through verse number 5. And so as you found that, let's do stand together to honor the public reading of the Word of God. We'll read our text for this morning, then we'll pray and see what the Lord has for our teaching and our understanding today. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 1, "Finally, brethren, pray for us, that the word of the Lord may have free course and be glorified, even as it is with you, and that we may be delivered from unreasonable and wicked men, for all men have not faith. But the Lord is faithful, who shall establish you and keep you from evil. And we have confidence in the Lord touching you, that ye both do and will do the things which we command you. And the Lord direct your hearts into the love of God and into the patient waiting for Christ." Amen. Let's pray together. Lord, we do thank you for the reading of the Word of God this morning. And Lord, we thank you for how you've already blessed us. You've blessed us during our time of congregational singing and worship, our fellowship together, Lord. And Lord, wonderful blessing that you've blessed us with Brooklyn, sharing with us in the special music, that song that never grows old, "Jesus Loves Me, This I Know." Lord, we're so humbled by that because we know that we are unworthy of your love. We're unworthy of your grace. But you've loved us and you've proven that love by your death on the cross of Calvary. You gave your life for us. And Lord, we pray today that you would speak to our hearts through the preaching of your word and by the presence of the Holy Spirit and draw us closer to yourself that we might learn more of you. And then, Lord, that we can be better equipped to serve you. But we also pray, as always, for souls to be saved and lives to be changed and for revival to come. We'll thank you for all that you do. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Thank you for standing for the Word of God. Well, here in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, we're talking about some responsibilities in light of the second coming of Christ. You'll notice how in verse number 5, that he said, "The Lord direct your hearts into the love of God and into the patient waiting for Christ." You realize that's what we're doing now, amen? We're waiting for the return of Christ, for the second coming of the Lord Jesus. He's going to come in the rapture. He's going to catch us up. We've studied that in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. We'll be caught up in the air. The dead in Christ will rise from the graves first, will be resurrected. We will be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We'll be caught up together with the Lord to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. And so, but in light of that, knowing that it is imminent, knowing that the rapture of the church can take place at any time, the coming of Christ is very near, we do have some responsibilities in light of this truth of his second coming. And Paul is being sure to let the Thessalonian believers know and to let us know as well, and gives us some practical advice on these things. And we need this. It concerns prayer, protection, perseverance, and patience. And in verse 1 and verse number 2, we looked at that the last time and understood how that the Apostle Paul is teaching us that we need to pray, and how we need prayer. It is a responsibility that we have, and we need to pray for the man of God. Verse 3 again, or verse 1 of chapter 3, "Finally, brethren, pray for us, that the word of the Lord may have free course and be glorified, even as it is with you. And that we may be delivered from unreasonable and wicked men, for all men have not faith." And so he says, pray for the man of God. Paul says to the Thessalonians, pray for me. But he says, pray for us. Not only him, but Timothy and others of the disciples, of the apostles, of the preachers, of the men of God. And we need to do that still today. Two specific things to pray for is for the delivery of the word in verse number 1. And then for deliverance from opposition in verse number 2. Pray that the word of God would be delivered.
faithfully, have free course, be glorified, as it tells us there in verse number 1. And also pray for the deliverance from opposition, because we are living in a day where many, many are opposed to the preaching of God's word. And so pray for the man of God. But then there's also this matter of protection. And in verse number 3, if you'll notice here, another responsibility and some other advice that he gives us, we need to rely on the protection of God. Amen. Rely on the Lord's protection of our lives, of our families, of our homes. Rely on the protection of God. Verse 3. But the Lord is faithful, who will establish you and keep you from evil. Isn't that a wonderful verse? First of all, we can't always trust people, can we? I mean, we've learned that. We would like to. We would wish that we could. But we find out through our own experiences that we cannot always trust the people around us. But I submit to you this, church, we can always trust the Lord. Can you say amen to that? Amen. We can always trust God. And why is that? Because he's faithful. He has been faithful. He is faithful. And he will always be faithful to his children. Amen. He has proven his faithfulness. And the Bible speaks of that here. But the Lord is faithful. Notice a couple of things, two or three things here. First of all, we can rely on the protection of God because he is faithful to establish us. Faithful to establish us. But the Lord, verse 3, but the Lord is faithful who shall establish you. The word establish, same word as establish. The Lord is faithful to establish or to establish you. That word established is a wonderful word and has a good meaning. The meaning of the word is this, the definition, to make firm or stable, to cause to grow and multiply, to gain full recognition or acceptance. That's what it means to be established. And all of those things are very important in our lives as believers and really are very important in our lives in the light of the second coming of Jesus Christ. Amen. The fact that Jesus is coming soon. One of the reasons that Paul wrote to the Thessalonians in the first place was to establish the believers in their faith and in their lifestyle of serving the Lord, of living for him. Back in the first letter, 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 1 and 2, he said, wherefore, when we could no longer forbear, we thought it good to be left at Athens alone and sent Timotheus, our brother and minister of God and our fellow laborer in the gospel of Christ, listen, to establish you and to comfort you concerning your faith, to establish you and comfort you concerning your faith. And then in that same chapter, looking down to verse 12 and verse 13, he said, and the Lord make you to increase and abound in love one toward another and toward all men, even as we do toward you, to the end he may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness before God, even our Father, at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all his saints. Do you see how he connects it with the coming of Christ, the second coming of Christ, and that a responsibility that you and I have in light of the truth of the soon coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, of his return, of his calling us to himself. In light of all of this and all that we understand, that it can happen, the rapture at any moment, and then the second coming is going to be after that, we know that in light of all of that, one of the key things that we need is to be established in the Lord. Amen. To be established in our faith, to know what we believe, amen, to really believe what we believe, to know what we believe, to know our doctrine, to have a lifestyle that is in accordance to the word of God, a lifestyle that we're living that will be pleasing to the Lord. You see, that's something we've got to trust the Lord in and understand that he is faithful to do that. He can establish us. It's extremely important that we be established in our faith and in our relationship to the Lord, and that we are able to grow and to multiply to the point that we may be fully recognized as followers of Jesus Christ. That's the real, the meaning of that word, to be established. And by the way, that is why God has given us the Bible, and that is why God has also has given us the local church to establish us. The Bible teaches us and would establish us. But also being a part of the church, being a part of the local church, goes a long way to helping us to be established in our faith and in our relationship with the Lord in these last days. Let me read a few verses over in Ephesians chapter 4. If you want to look there with me, there's several of them. In fact, from Ephesians chapter 4 and from verse 4 really all the way down through verse number 15, you can see this truth of how that God has given us the Bible and God has given us the local church in order to establish us in our faith and in our relationship with the Lord, our lifestyle in living for Him. And so if you'd like to follow along, let me just read this, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called. That vocation wherewith you are called is the Christian life. Amen. It is. He's talking about living the Christian life. That's your vocation. You know, you may have a job. You may have a particular skill that you do on that job. And we refer to that as your vocation. But for the Christian, look, our real vocation, our real life is all about living for Him. Amen. We can work our jobs and do things in order to support our family, but our real vocation is living our life for the Lord Jesus Christ. And He says that you walk worthy of this. The word walk has to do with your lifestyle, has to do with the way that you're living, where you go, what you do, and such things as that. And so He says we need to walk worthy of being a Christian. And how do we do that? Well, with all lowliness, verse 2. With all lowliness and weakness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. And then watch this, there is one body and one Spirit, even as ye are called, and one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Wherefore He said, when He ascended up on high, He led captivity captive and gave gifts to men. Now He that ascended, what is it but that He also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that He might fill all things. It's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ and His resurrection. And He gave some. Here's where the church comes in. He gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting. That would carry that idea of being established, maturing, perfecting of the saints for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect or mature man, under the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro, notice, carried about with every wind of doctrine by sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. That's where the Word of God comes in, where the Bible comes in, to give us the true doctrine, amen, the true teaching of God. And then verse 15, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up into Him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. And so it's talking about how that both the Bible and the church, God has given that to us for that purpose of establishing us, of maturing us, of perfecting us, of helping us. And you see, especially in these last days that we're living in, we need to understand that God wants us to be mature believers in the Lord. Amen. And He wants us to live lives that would be pleasing to Him. He wants to, I believe He really does, He wants to be able to say, well done, thou good and faithful servant, when He returns. Amen. And so we need to be established. Well, God's faithful to do that for us. He'll establish us, and he'll do it by his word and also by being a part of his church. He's faithful to establish us. Rely on the protection of God and his faithfulness to establish. But then also, he is faithful to protect us as well. He is faithful to protect us. Back in the text in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 and verse number 3 once again. But the Lord is faithful, who will establish you, and then notice, and keep you from evil. You see that? He'll not only establish us, but he'll protect us as well. And this is really such a wonderful promise, this verse here, such a wonderful promise for new Christians and really and old ones too. Now, Paul was thinking, I think here, about the young believers in Thessalonica. Remember, this is the early church. These are in the early days, the first century, the early days of Christianity. And this was a new thing, this message of the gospel of Jesus Christ, his death, his burial, his resurrection, and his coming again. These were new things. The Apostle Paul tells in other places about how that God chose him really to deliver to him the mystery of the church, of the people of God, of the age of grace that you and I are living in right now. And so these were new things here, and being such new things, understand these were young believers here at Thessalonica. Not necessarily by age, but young in regards that the church itself was young. And so they were just learning. And as a new Christian then, or a new Christian even today, a new Christian is always exposed to all kinds of dangers. Satan will do all that he can to turn us away from the simplicity of the gospel. He tries to bring confusion. He tries to bring in false ideas. He tries to bring in man's philosophy and really just all kinds of things. And for a new believer, a new Christian, are so susceptible to the cults, and so susceptible to false teaching, and so susceptible, they need to be grounded in the Word of God. And that, by the way, that's our responsibility as a local church. Amen. That we teach and preach the Bible in such a way that people can clearly understand what it means to be saved and what it means to be a Christian, a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. Satan will do all he can to turn them away, but we can have confidence in the faithfulness of God, and that Jesus, in fact, himself prayed that we would be kept from the devil, that we would be kept from the evil one. Back over in John chapter 17, John chapter 17, we refer to this as the high priestly prayer of the Lord Jesus Christ. And really, when you think of the Lord's Prayer, we refer to Matthew chapter 6 as the Lord's Prayer oftentimes, but as I think I've told you before, it's really better to refer to it as the model prayer, as the model prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, the model prayer. But here you have the Lord's Prayer. Because this is the Lord praying, and he prays on our behalf and the behalf of all of his disciples. You'll notice how in chapter 17 of John, verse 1, these words spake Jesus and lifted up his eyes to heaven, said, Father, the hour is come, glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee. And he continues on through the chapter in his prayer, and he prays for his disciples, and he prays for us. If you look down to verse 13, and I'll read down through verse 17 in John chapter 17, verse 13. And now come I to thee, Jesus continues his prayer. And now come I to thee, and these things I speak in the world, that they might have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I've given them thy word, and the world hath hated them, because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil. Keep them from the evil. And he's praying for his disciples. He's praying for their protection, you see. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. Now watch this, if you'll drop down, if you're looking in John 17 and verse number 20. Neither pray I for these alone, talking about his disciples that were with him in that day, and he prayed for their protection. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word. Now, who is that? Well, that's you and me. We've believed Matthew and Mark and Luke and John. We've believed the New Testament. We believe the Bible. He said he's praying for those who would believe what his disciples have reported, what his disciples have declared. And he says, I pray, neither pray I for these alone, but for them also, which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And so Jesus himself prayed for our protection. He prayed for our protection from the evil one. And you know, I believe that he does that. I've seen him do it in my life. And I would suggest to you and understand that the closer you walk with the Lord, the closer you're living a life for him, and you're pleasing him, and the decisions you make, you make those decisions based upon seeking out his will and the understanding of the scriptures of the Word of God. And you just walk close with the Lord, then I believe you can be sure of his protection. That doesn't mean that life won't get hard. That doesn't mean that you'll never get sick. That doesn't mean that you'll never have difficulties or troubles, because in this world, he said, ye shall have tribulation. All that comes from the world. But as far as the attacks of Satan and of the wicked one, wicked things of this world, I really believe that we who walk with the Lord Jesus Christ in such a wicked world as we're living in now, I really believe that he is faithful to keep us protected from that wickedness of this world. Amen. And so he's faithful to protect us, faithful to establish us. Can I say also, number three, he is faithful to keep us. Faithful to keep us. In John chapter number 10, John chapter 10, let's read a couple of verses or so there. John chapter 10, verse 27, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father, which gave them me, is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. He is faithful to keep those that are his. Can you say amen to that? Listen, the Bible teaches very plainly. People like to make fun of us sometimes and mock us as Baptists. They say, well, you believe in that once saved, always saved. I mark it down. I believe in it because it's what the Bible teaches. The Bible says so. Jesus says, no man, once you belong to him, once you've been saved, once you've been born again, no man, nothing can take you out of his hand. Amen. And in 1 John chapter 5, you remember verse 11 and following, and this is the record, that God hath given unto us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life. He that hath not the Son of God hath not life. These things have been written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. Amen. That you may believe on the name of the Son of God. John chapter 5, verse 24. He that heareth my words and believeth on him that has sent me hath everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. Amen. The Bible makes it plain. For those that are truly born again, bought by the blood of Jesus, he not only is faithful to save us when we called upon his name, but he is faithful to keep us as well, to keep us in his hands. And we can rely on that. Can you say amen to that? We can rely on the protection of God, that he'll establish us and protect us and he'll keep us. But then another piece of advice that Apostle Paul would give to us here in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 would be in verse number 4. And that is that in light of the second coming of Christ, we need to persevere for the glory of God. Persevere for the glory of God. And so we need to pray for the man of God. Rely on the protection of God. But we need to persevere for the glory of God. Verse number 4. And we have confidence in the Lord touching you, that ye both do and will do the things which we command you. Now notice this, what the Apostle Paul is saying here. He believed. Evidently, I think obviously, he believed that in the Thessalonian believers. He believed in them. They believed in Christ, and he believed in them. In other words, he knew they were saved. Amen. And he had confidence that they would come out on top, no matter what the persecution or the trial may be. He was confident that they would persevere. That word persevere, an easy way to think of it is just by that statement we say sometimes, keep on keeping on. Amen. You ever said that? Just keep on keeping on. That's what it means to persevere. Keep on keeping on for the glory of God. And the thing is, church, when you are right with God, I really believe that you'll do just that. You know, the times that we're not keeping on, that we're not persevering for the Lord, would be those times that we're backslidden. Amen, or me. When we've backed off of our commitment, when we've laid out of church, when we've slacked up in our prayer life or reading the scriptures and studying the Bible in other areas of our life, whenever we've backed up, whenever we slide back, whenever we go backwards, then you're really not persevering for God's glory. You're not moving forward, are you? You're moving backwards. We need to persevere. We need to keep on keeping on, keeping on moving forward. And you say, well, how do you do that? Because sometimes in this life, it seems like it gets hard to slip up. And, you know, there's, I think somebody wrote a book one time, something like 2 steps forward, 3 steps backward, or 3 steps forward, 2 steps backward, something like that. And that in our lives, sometimes as Christians, we go forward a little bit, we progress some, and then we back up. We progress some, we hit a wall or something spiritually, and we back up. Now, I want to say to us, there's really no reason why we should be having to live a Christian existence like that. Amen. We have the Word of God. We have the local church. We have brothers and sisters in Christ. There's really no reason why we shouldn't persevere for the glory of God and keep on keeping on for His glory. So how do you do that? Well, as I said, you have the Word of God, you have the people of God, and that helps. But I think of, along with that, and perhaps first of all, could I just say, keep your eyes on Jesus. Amen. I really think if you just keep your eyes on Jesus, stay in the will of God, but you take your eyes off of Jesus and you'll get out of the will of God, and then mark it down, my friend, that's when you'll have some problems. Amen. That's when you'll have problems. You remember the story of Peter? If you would like to look there with me, it's in Matthew chapter 14. Matthew chapter 14, and I'll read a number of verses there. In Matthew chapter 14, and so we'll pick up verse 22. Matthew chapter 14, verse 22. And straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and to go before him unto the other side while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. But the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, "It is a spirit," and they cried out for fear. But straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, "Be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid." And Peter, now watch this, and Peter answered him and said, "Lord, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water." And he said, "Come." And when Peter was come down out of the ship, notice the words, he walked on the water. Did you say that? He did. He walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried, saying, "Lord, save me." And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, "O thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt?" Now, where did Peter mess up? Well, I think Peter deserves a lot of credit because he's the only one willing to step out. And he stepped out, and we use the term step out on faith. And that's what he did. He stepped out on faith. He said, "Lord, if you call me, I'll come to you on the water." And so he stepped out on faith on the water, and the Bible says that he walked on the water. I think that we could very well picture it in our minds that as Peter climbs out of the boat, steps out on that water, that all the while that he walked, his eyes was on Jesus. He was looking towards Jesus. He was going to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, boisterous, when his eyes, instead of being focused on Jesus, when his eyes did something like this, When his eyes began to look around, he saw the wind boisterous. He was afraid, and he began to sink. And so the problem was that Peter took his eyes off the Lord. And I really believe that that's the problem with Christians who find themselves in a backslidden state. It's because they have taken their eyes off of the Lord. They've taken their eyes off of Jesus. To keep on keeping on for the glory of God, we've got to keep our focus and we've got to keep our eyes on the Lord Jesus Christ. And there's where I say the Word of God is what helps us in that. The church and the family of God is what helps us in that. To keep our focus, to keep our eyes on the Lord Jesus Christ himself. And so persevere for the glory of God. Let me give you the last bit of advice that the Apostle Paul gives us in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. And it's practical as well. And that is, we need to be patiently waiting for the Lord's return. Patiently wait for the Lord's return. Verse number 5. And the Lord direct your hearts into the love of God and into the patient waiting for Christ. The patient waiting for Christ. Do you remember James chapter 5 and two verses there, verse 7 and verse 8, where James writes this? He says, "Be patient therefore, brethren, unto the coming of the Lord. Behold, the husbandman waiteth for the precious fruit of the earth, and hath long patience for it, until he receive the early and latter rain. Be ye also patient, establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord draweth nigh." Now, James is saying that same thing that Paul is saying here. He's saying that we need to be patient in waiting for the Lord's return, waiting for Christ, knowing that he is coming and that he is coming soon. Patiently wait for the Lord. And he gives an illustration here about a husbandman. A husbandman you think of as a gardener, as a farmer. That would be a husbandman. And he plants the seed and he waits for it patiently to get the fruit. Those of you that that grow gardens and planted gardens, you know what that is like. You wait for those tomatoes to come on the vine, and then you wait for them to turn ripe because you're looking ahead to making that tomato sandwich this summer, amen. But you're patiently waiting for that. You wait for the things of the garden. Well, in a real sense, that's happening right now. It's happening today in respect to the second coming of Christ and in respect to the church or the body of Christ. Because you see, the husbandman with a capital H, the husbandman, the Lord Jesus Christ, he is now sitting at the right hand of God in heaven, and he is waiting for the precious fruit of the earth. And he says, what does that mean? He's waiting until that time when that perhaps that last soul is saved and the Father says, "Okay, son, it's time now. And go and get my children, go and get the church." Jesus is waiting for that time because, you know, Jesus said himself, told his disciples that no man knows the day or the hour. Only the Father knows that. Jesus would say to them that he did not even know himself when that day, when that hour, when that moment would come. But he's waiting for it. And don't you know that he's waiting patiently? He's there at the right hand of God. And he's waiting patiently this age of grace. But one day that great man of patience, the Lord Jesus Christ, he will rise up from his place at the Father's right hand on the throne in heaven. And the Bible says the Lord himself, he's going to step out on the cloud. There's going to be the sound of a trumpet. The Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel. The dead in Christ shall rise first, and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. I don't know about you, but that's what I'm looking for. Amen. Not looking for the undertaker. I'm looking for the upper taker. I'm looking for the Lord to rise up and step out and call us to glory to be with him. And that day is coming. We are patiently waiting for it. And here's the thing. There's a lot of people in the world today, they will ridicule us because of that belief. They'll say, well, 2,000 plus years now, they've been saying that Jesus is coming and he hadn't come yet. Say, what? Well, don't that make you kind of step back a little bit? Don't that make you think 2,000 years he hadn't come back? I tell you this, my friend, yeah, it does make me think. It makes me excited because I know I'm a lot closer to it now. I know that every day, as every day comes by, we're getting closer and closer to the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we are just waiting for him. Amen. Waiting for him. We need patience to do that, especially with this world that we're living in now, the turmoil, the things that are happening. We do need patience. We need the patience to wait, rest upon our realization of the unchanging love of God. As Paul said again in our text in verse 5, the Lord direct your hearts into the love of God and into the patient waiting for Christ. How is it that we can patiently wait for him? I think when our hearts and our minds are especially focused on remembering what an amazing and awesome love that God has for us. Just like the song, Jesus loves me, this I know, the Bible tells me so. If we will remind ourselves of that, if we'll sing that little song to ourselves through the week, if we'll remind ourselves of the wonderful, amazing love of God, then I really believe it'll help us along the way of patiently waiting for his return. But then watch this. I'll close with this, a verse from the Old Testament. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. That's what God will do for us as we patiently wait for him. He will help us. He will strengthen us. He will establish us. He will protect us. He's faithful to do all of those things. But this word here in Isaiah 40 verse 31, but they that wait upon the Lord. What is your understanding of what it means to wait? Sometimes we think, well, that means just sit back and relax and you don't do anything. You're just waiting. Somebody comes along and you're sitting on a bench somewhere and they say, well, what are you doing? Well, I'm just waiting. You know, you're just waiting. But really what the word means to wait upon the Lord, it really means to serve him. And we should be patiently serving him in these last days. We use the word, don't we? In particular, in a restaurant. You've heard the term the wait staff of the restaurant. Waitresses, waiters, people who wait on you. What are they doing when you go to the restaurant? They are serving you. Amen? They'll come and ask you, do you need some more water? Do you need some more coffee? Do you need some more tea? They come and take your order. What would you like to have to eat today? And they will wait on you. You need some more napkins. They'll go get you some more napkins. You dropped your silverware on the floor. They say, that's okay. They'll bring you another one. They will wait on you. They are serving you. Amen. That's the word, wait. When we are patiently waiting for the Lord, it's not sitting back and twiddling our thumbs and doing nothing, but it is serving him, worshiping him, loving him, honoring him, committing our life to him. And you know, in all of those things, but I think especially that aspect of waiting for the Lord, understanding it as serving him, I really think that it goes a long way to keeping us from backsliding, amen, to keeping our eyes on Jesus, keeping our focus right, to keep on keeping on, to trust God even in tumultuous times like we're living in now, to trust him and know that he is faithful to establish us and he is faithful to protect us and he will keep us, to know that he'll do all this for us and just wait on him and serve him as we get so close to his coming. Amen? Amen. Let's go ahead and stand together, church, our heads bowed, our eyes closed for prayer. And as we do, let me say to someone that may be have picked up this message online,
And friend, if you're really in your heart, you know that you haven't been waiting for the Lord because you haven't really been concerned about the coming of the Lord. You don't know that you've trusted Christ as your Savior. If we have asked you the question, if you were to die today, do you know if you'd be in heaven or not? You need to be able to answer that question. You need to be able to say that by faith in Jesus Christ, I'm ready for heaven. But if not, then listen, the Word of God shows us very plainly that the Lord is not only waiting on that time for His return, but He's waiting on you. He's waiting on you to believe His Word, to believe His gospel, and by faith to trust in Him that He might save you and give you the promise of everlasting life. And then you can join us, join the church, and you can serve Him as we get close to His return. If that's never happened for your life, our prayer at Grace Baptist Church is that it would happen soon, that you could call upon the Lord, and you could even do so even this moment. And we'll sure praise the Lord for you and with you, because you call on His name in believing prayer. His promise is He'll save you, give you life everlasting and a home in heaven. Amen. Let's pray, church. Lord, thank you for the Word of God today. And thank you for the wonderful promise of your soon return. Lord, help us to be faithful and serve you as we wait for you. And we'll thank you for all you do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's sing the song together, Brother Tim.
Page 270. Thank you.